Welcome to this week's installment of Reading with Robin, your number one destination since 2002 for insightful author interviews and discussions on everything literary. And with no further introduction, your host, Robin Call.
I have been looking forward to this interview for a really long time, ever since I saw the women walking around BEA Book Expo in these awesome costumes to present to the world The Secrets We Kept, the brand new novel by Lara Prescott. I am thrilled to chat with her. The novel has been out just a few weeks. It's been translated into many, many languages, adapted for film. Lara received her MFA from the Michener Center for Writers at the University of Texas. She studied political science at American University, worked in D.C. All of it's wrapped up into this gorgeous novel. I've been carrying this around and staring at it. It's the most gorgeous advance copy I've ever seen. And I'm such a book person, so the Reading with Robin audience knows that I'm like a little excited to chat with her. Welcome to the show, Lara.
Oh, thank you so much for having me. It's so great to speak with you.
Such a treat. I remember being at Book Expo 5 months ago, I guess, and mm-hmm. I'm like, who are all those women on those awesome costumes? What is going on? And and I kept seeing the poster for the book, and I just was like, that book. I need that book. And I read somewhere that you wrote a book that you'd want to read for your mom, your sisters, like that kind of book. And this is just like such a great, awesome read on so many levels. Congratulations.
Oh, thank you so much. I mean, the team at Knopf just did such an unbelievable job, from dressing up as you know, having my characters come to life. And
crazy.
It was just absolutely amazing. I'm so happy you saw them in person.
I was like walking around
cried.
like, who are these women? What are they doing? And it's funny because I put it together slowly, not really slowly. I was like, oh, who is that? And then I saw the posters, and you know, there was such a fabulous depiction, and they're so smart, and Knopf is amazing. So whatever they're putting out there, and I was like, okay, I need that. I need that. I remember meeting with somebody in one of the spaces, and I just kept staring at that poster and just knowing, then reading all of the background. Just so fascinating, from your advisor, Elizabeth McCracken.
Who is
a magician and a marvel. Working with her and hearing about this famous male writer telling you about how to write this and edit it. Because, you know, as a book person, I love all of those stories. So start wherever you like, but I would love to hear more about that.
I think it's actually a lesson I think I learned from Elizabeth McCracken, who not only is just the most amazing writer, but an amazing teacher.
Yeah.
And she gives back to students in a way that is just not a given. And mm-hmm. I think something she told us was about when to trust your gut. Mm-hmm. And also how to find your readers and not write something that's not from your heart or not mm-hmm. something that you would want to read. You're not trying to impress, you know, some other audience. You're finding who do you think would really respond. And like you said, for me, I wrote a book that I would like to read. But my whole family is a book of readers, and my mother and my sister and just something that I could see, you know, the women in my family mm-hmm. Pick up and enjoy. And so I think when you have a negative feedback from someone who you don't necessarily enjoy their writing or want to mm-hmm. write like them, and, you know, having someone explain to you or mansplain to you what they think you need to do to write more like them, I think that's always, you know, something to raise a red flag. And
pun intended.
Yeah, and I think that for me, you know, I think I was so far along, I was about to send out my manuscript, that I did just brush it off. But I think the danger is, you know, for people who are just starting novels or just starting to write and listening to those voices of negativity or voices of people telling you, you need to do it like I'm doing it or you're doing it wrong. And I think that can be a danger to, especially, you know, young writers just starting out. And I think it takes a while to start trusting your gut, like Elizabeth said.
It's so true in that, and on so many levels that advice does translate in. And being in the presence of, I mean, so having the opportunity, and Elizabeth is somebody who, as you say, is just so generous and takes to heart the people that she's working with. And we were fortunate mm-hmm. enough to sit down with her when she was in Rhode Island for New England Booksellers last
year.
Oh, great. And yeah, I was like, I just want to sit at this table all day and listen to I had been following her on Twitter forever, and I didn't even really put it together initially. I'm like, because it just everything she writes, I wanted to read. So when I read that part of your story, and I'm speaking with Lara Prescott, the author of the one of I don't know the one of the books you better just not miss, The Secrets We Kept. It's one of my favorites. I read it months ago and did a bit of rereading before we chatted. Although there's never enough time to go through the whole thing, I feel like we could. You know, just spend so much time. I mean, between the
Absolutely.
Timing of the book, yeah, the book coming out, the connection to Dr. Zhivago, the mansplaining, banned book week, and everything that's happening in D.C. And what you used to do. Like, there's so much here. And at the heart of it is this story. It's like, don't bother me, I'm reading. It's such a joy. And I took out my old copy of Dr. Zhivago. I haven't rewatched the movie, but that's on the list. And so to read a book that brings so much joy, makes you think, and is just so clever and beautifully done, it's the whole deal. And so getting to chat with you just, you know, punctuates the whole experience. I'm dying to know who the guy was.
to give it, that person any more attention.
No, but I'm like, famous male writer. Let's see.
I know.
But of course, you know, you're a reader. You're curious. You're like trying to. And I've heard this story told in different ways where that is the message of listening to your gut, working with people that you trust, being able to get your voice out there on the page. And this book just has such a remarkable journey. And I think I was maybe 80 or 90 pages into it, and I was like, her name's Lara. The movie.
Yep.
So I put that together in that way before reading certain material. So your connection to the story and your mom's credit in naming you, I mean, talk about how that all ties in.
Yeah, I think I can say it goes back to, you know, my birth when my mother and my father named me Lara.
Wow.
It was, you know, my mother's favorite film, the David mm-hmm. Lean adaptation, and one of her favorite books. And she was always just, you know, one of these people who's just obsessed with everything Russia.
Uh-huh.
You know, she had a cat named Mika, and like it was just part of, you know, her love of Russian culture. And so I would always watch that movie growing up, or it would be on all the time. My mom always has, you know, the old movies on constantly. And Zhivago, mm-hmm. especially during Christmas time, I think just getting the snow, not that it's not a Christmas movie at all, but I think they play it around that time for some reason because of the snow.
Yes. Winter, I don't know.
Yeah.
Russia just sort of evokes that, I guess.
And I think that, you know, growing up watching the movie, and then I finally read the book when I was in high school.
Mm-hmm.
I, too, then started going through my Russian phase and wanting to read all the Russian writers. And and then finally getting around to reading Zhivago and just connecting so much with Boris Pasternak's book.
Mm-hmm.
That it's been just a part of my life. I've read it every couple years. I've read all the different translations. I mean, not all the different English translations, I should say. It's just been something kind of in the back of my head of, you know, I have this connection with this book, but I really didn't ever think I would be writing about Zhivago at all until 2014, when I found out about the CIA's mission to use the book as a weapon during the Cold War. And that was first reported on in the Washington Post by Peter Finn and Petra Kuve.
Mm-hmm.
And they later wrote a nonfiction book that's just amazing called The Zhivago Affair. And I just pored over those CIA documents. They're all online, and they're heavily redacted. So
of course.
You just, yeah, those people, the names of the officers involved are lost to history, at least, you know, as far as we know.
Sure.
And I just thought it was the perfect way to kind of fictionalize and filling the blanks of what could have happened and who were these people that accomplished this almost stranger than fiction, real life mission.
Yeah.
And so that was my way into writing the novel. And then the research took me, you know, all over the world, and different people's point of views. And I was really just drawn to women, as the story, as soon as the story began, I started envisioning it from the typist's point of view. And I think it is my background in working in Washington, D.C., in this male-dominated field of politics that just made me really more interested, to be frank, about those women.
Oh, and then you think about the women and just the idea of typing, like what they were typing and the way, and I'm, you know, thinking back to the novel about, like, knowing that they had to just keep going and that these were secrets, but, like, it's like really big stuff that they were typing. like they're actually typing. And you think about when you're like going through the keyboard really quickly and also processing what you're reading and then what to do about it. I mean, it was part of their job. And so like that idea of that and all of these books that we're learning about so many women that did things from like code breakers and the mathematicians and all of these kinds of things are just it's just our time in so many ways. And so this book is just punctuates that, which is a passion and its fascination with all these pieces of history that we are learning about and before they're lost, and also filling in the blanks of these stories with fiction. And it's just so glorious. And I'm talking with Lara Prescott, The Secrets We Kept, brand new book. It's just out a few weeks, and it is everywhere, and it's being translated everywhere, and movie rights and all of it. And you live in Texas, and I read somewhere like you're not in New York in the middle of the – well, you might be there now. Are you there? You're on tour now. Are you in New York?
I am. Yeah, I'm in New York now.
Are you in New York now?
I live in Austin, Texas. Yeah, I had a book event last night in Brooklyn.
That's
it was
amazing. I
missed
it, and we missed you in Boston. I was like – I just tweeted at you. I'm like, I know, we're not far.
That's right.
And we're so bummed that there was something that couldn't be changed. But that it's very different for writers. Writer to not be constantly, it's exhausting in New York and Brooklyn and all of the events. And so there's a sense of right now you're in the thick of it and you're all of these wonderful things and your event tour is amazing. Everyone go to LaraPrescott.com and find out where she'll be. And if you're lucky enough to be near there, go. But it is different. I love Austin. What an awesome city. And the best bookstore there ever.
Oh, Book People is the best.
Yeah. So great. We went a few years ago and met up with Amanda Airward and then went across to that store where we spent many hours. We spent many hours there. It's such an awesome city. But what is that like, sort of being in the throes of a first book tour and such amazingly received red carpet treatment for this book? What's going on?
I think, well, I'm just kind of just starting out on the tour. So I did a few dates in Texas, and then I was in Boston, and now New York. So it still feels pretty new to me. But it's just been, it's so amazing to meet readers in person, and people have already read it or have heard about it from someone and learning how they heard about it. I'm even hearing from readers who have had a connection with someone working at the CIA. I had someone that say their mother worked in the records department at the CIA during that time, and you really brought this to life for me.
That's really cool.
It's been amazing.
That's the thing. Like, you don't know who's cut. I mean, you may get, like, little notes passed to you, like, more information for the next. Because everybody that has a connection to a story in some way, you know, hopefully finds their way to either email you, send you a message through, you know, you're on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, so you can send messages. But people who have a connection to the story in some way love to share that. So I can only imagine the stories that people will share with you on tour and just the people that sort of come out to say hi, and there's nothing like readers. And this book is just, it's got everything that I love about a book, between the characters and the connection to the story and what was going on in that part of history and the way it's even more relevant and, you know, just such a light shone on all of this right now. Like, so is, like, how is that? You know, what are you hearing from people? So the book's been out for, like, what, 3 weeks?
September 3rd, so a couple of weeks.
People are reading it and...
Yeah, it's, I will say, even if they don't, hearing from people that have been touched by the book has been the best part, and made it feel so worthwhile, all the years of work that took to write it. I had a woman who said she cut a piece of the book out to keep with her that resonated so much with her.
And her relationship, in the
past. And I couldn't believe it. I actually took a screenshot of the email to keep with me, and just like while I'm traveling and say like, this has had an impact because, you know, you write something and you see that it might be doing well but actually hearing from a reader and it makes it, there's like that physical connection and you're like, oh my gosh, this woman read it and she felt so moved by it that she cut a piece of it out because it touched her so much. And that's what you hope to do as a writer. That's why I'm a writer in the first place. And so this was amazing.
That is such a great story. And also she cut up a book. I love that. Books are meant to be moved into, and I'm looking at your tour. So your next event is at the International Spy Museum in Washington.
Yes.
How cool is that? And you're off to the UK, and then you're back, and you're in Texas and everywhere, Arizona. The book festival, those are so much fun. Oh, then Milan and Rome. it's dizzying and how fabulous. But, yeah, to hear the different ways that people are being touched by this book, and it's The Secrets We Kept. So you put secrets in a title right away. You have my attention, and this, right? And this, and I was reading. So you submitted a story to Highlights when you were a young woman.
I did. When I was in third grade.
I was obsessed
with getting into Highlights magazine.
Of course, absolutely.
Because you know, I had a subscription. You always see in the dentist's office or the doctor's office, and there's that page that's the where the kids can submit their drawings and stuff. And so I sent this like really, really long story in, and of course they wouldn't publish this like giant story, but I don't think my mom had the heart to tell me that this is probably not going anywhere. But that was my first literary rejection.
It's great to be able to trace something back to, you know, because there are writers who will say, you know, I've always wanted to be a writer, or this just came to me, or, you know, people come to writing in different ways. And how did your time in D.C., you know, and talk about like fake news, I read that somewhere, and just all of the things that we're told, I mean, this is, I wish I could say an unprecedented time in our history for a lot of this news, but it just seems to be getting more and more intense. And I was just talking before, like I'm balancing all of that noise with my passion for reading. It's been a great antidote, but you can't escape it. So to talk about, and you'll be back in D.C. with your event. So what's that going to be like?
I'm really excited to head to D.C. One, I did do some research at the Spy Museum there, so I'm excited to go back. And then Politics and Prose, I used to live down the street, and so that was my bookstore, and it's just going to be such a fantastic time. But, you know, people that I worked with in politics, they're coming out and super supportive. It was an interesting time because you have these groups of people that, you know, it is their whole life to work on these campaigns, and they work harder than I've ever seen anyone work. And at the same time, even, you know, if you're working for the good guys, as I'll put in like air quotes.
No, we know who the good guys are. Yes.
it's still a system that's tainted by money and all of these factors that go into Washington. And so I've always been fascinated with that, but also how words can change people's minds, because that was what my job was, to write ad copy or speeches or tweets that would help further along agenda or get someone to come out to vote. And I've always been fascinated with that. And then when I learned about how books used to be used in this like grand way with the CIA, it just seemed like such a like syncing up of these interests of mine. And now I think you see the same thing happening in fake news and Twitter bots and all of these things that
the Twitter bots.
I mean, fake Twitter accounts, fake YouTube, you know, all these things of, you know, it's the same tactic. I mean, so I'm sorry, it's a different tactic, but it's the same effort to change people's minds or to get them to think a certain way. And it can be a dangerous thing. It can be a good thing. And I'm always fascinated by the juxtaposition of those two things.
Yeah, it all comes together, and also the way that that can inform your writing. And having a job where that's what you were doing, was that, did that make the process of writing your manuscript like very dedicated? Are you very, you know, sort of seat and chair, your timing? There's just, I mean, also, and the research. So much energy and time and really diligence to this craft.
So I had gone to grad school, and so I was no longer working in politics. This was my full-time job to write the novel. When I was working in politics, one of the frustrations was that I just, you know, I would get home at midnight and not want to write or do anything, and I felt like I was losing that part of me. So I had to leave to be able to kind of follow this dream of writing.
Wow. Yeah, I think, but in the skills that you have acquired with your job, that help propel the writing in a really cohesive way. And, you know, like, it's not like, well, I just think I'll write like today, or, you know, you have a really great system for keeping it going. And also all of the research. So that's a lot of, you know, sort of time filtering through and being, you know, really focused with all the other noise going around. Was that helpful in the process of writing the story?
Oh, absolutely. I think that it gives you this base to imagine the world and imagine what would have happened between people who are both historical figures but also people that have just come from my imagination, and then weaving those two, but making sure I had, you know, details like how would you take a streetcar if you were going to across D.C. in 1957, and what were the department stores like there? What was the food like? Just so much fun stuff that help inspire you and help inspire new scenes. You learn these little tidbits, or see a lot of photographs were really helpful of clothing, or what Perro del Quino, which is where Boris Pasternak lived, what did that look like? And wow. I actually even got to go and travel early on in my writing process to Russia, and that was so helpful as well.
So did they know you were there with the secret document of the book?
I don't think so.
did you ever feel like, wow, what's going on? I don't know. I sort of got so into the espionage and, you know, the who you must have researched in terms of, like, the typists and the, like, the fictional parts of that. How did you get that? Yeah, like, what was that part?
I was certainly Googling CIA and KGB a lot. So
like, did they come looking for you?
I don't know if I'm on some sort of list.
Yes, that's what I was
Googling,
like.
Googling this constantly.
Exactly, which is scary in and of itself. And I'm speaking with Lara Prescott. We're talking about her gorgeous brand new novel, her debut novel, The Secrets Were Kept. Thinking about all of the research that you must have done and the things that you would have, I mean, and it gets like a little freaky of like who's watching out, or right, your laptop wasn't confiscated or anything like that.
No. And I mean, I actually used to work with some former CIA officers that later went on to politics, and no one that was working in the 50s. This is more like the 90s, but
right.
So I don't know, never got my laptop confiscated. But I think I got a little more paranoid, you know, reading all of these things and
I would
reading about people in surveillance and, and, you know, I worked in politics, so yeah, maybe I was just like imagining things sometimes.
Right? You just sort of wonder. I was thinking about, I don't know, I was doing a bunch of research and going back and forth, and all of a sudden, like, videos for like White Nights, the Baryshnikov, Heinz dance kept coming up and just different Russian things. Like it was weird.
It's
Gregory
so
Hines.
Weird.
Yeah, I was like, why is Gregory Hines, why are Baryshnikov and Gregory Hines dancing across my computer while I'm looking up the sequence recapped? I mean, that was an
so
85
strange.
Move. But, like I thought that was interesting. And so, yeah, you know.
I mean, you have, who knows if it's Amazon or Google, like, you know, it's
somebody.
Yeah, if you're Googling
Siri.
Certain things, then you start. Happened to me a lot. Like, I would be Googling, and then, like, you know, other things would pop up, especially because there's old footage of, like, Stalin's funeral on YouTube or this grand parades in Moscow during that time. So I'd be watching a lot of that, and then I would be fed, you know, conspiracy videos on the other, you know, watch this next. I'm like, wait a minute, this is just a conspiracy. This isn't documentary footage.
And that's the thing
so
about
strange.
Reading, right? When you're so into a book, and also because of, you know, reading with Robin and the interviews, and so I'm always sort of researching and you go down these rabbit holes, but then it's like what it presents back to you. And because I'm a reader and I'm always sort of thinking about how stories play off of each other or what goes into it, I'm always, you know, like, wait, could it have been this? And then you think something and then it pops up. So it really, this is just such a book for that. It's just ripe for that because your mind is just going in all sorts of directions and thinking about the way you connected all of these stories and the dots to what might have been going on there. It's just such a joy of a read. And anybody that misses The Secrets Recapped, shame on you. This is like one of the best books. I loved it for everything. And I think, you know, it's the kind of thing where you're talking about Russia and the winter, you know, that Chicago comes out and it, for whatever reason during Christmas time. And this is like, you know, it came out in September, but I can just picture like cuddling up with it in the winter time too.
Oh,
and
yeah.
Just, you know, those kinds of books. And that's one of those kinds of books. It's out everywhere. Or give the audience just a little bit about the storyline because, you know, I don't ever want to give away. It's tricky with fiction, except for there's so much nonfiction connected to this. So people will know a little bit about the story. Won't give anything away.
So, and like, I guess in simple terms, it is a fictionalized account of this true mission that the CIA undertook in the 1950s to smuggle Boris Pasternak's Dr. Zhivago back behind the Iron Curtain where it was banned. And it was banned due to, I guess, so-called anti-Soviet content. And so my book travels back and forth between the East and the West. It's structured and it's told by a variety of different characters. And on the West, we have a group of CIA typists, and then we have two female operatives who I've imagined in those redacted names as being part of the mission, and how they used, and this sounds so strange, but it actually is true, they used the Brussels World's Fair in 1958 as their staging ground to smuggle these copies of Dr. Zhivago to Soviet visitors, and they used the Vatican Pavilion to do so. And so it sounds almost, you know, straight out of a movie, but it really happened. And so I kind of go through the mission of them smuggling it back, and then when Boris Pasternak wins the Nobel Prize, and kind of the elation that the CIA must have felt because their plan, you know, was successful. But, you know, so that's like a historical part of it. But it's really about these women and women who were working kind of in the shadows of the men. And so on the East, I also have Olga Ivanskaya, who was Boris Pasternak's real-life mistress and muse, and actually the person who inspired his character, Lara. And when I was reading her autobiography, really soon after I began my research, I was so taken by her story that I knew it was going to be told mostly from her perspective instead of from Boris Pasternak. I just thought this was my way in. And so this is a story, you know, told by women primarily, which wasn't exactly, it wasn't planned. It just kind of happened that way. But And it's a story of secrets and the secrets people keep, whether it's with the CIA or the secrets they keep from each other, or the secrets they keep to help, you know, preserve, protect others. And so you have, you know, a variety of secrets throughout the book. And really it's just, it's kind of a love letter also to Dr. Zhivago, and I wanted to write a romance as well.
It's so romantic, and I love that. It's a love letter to readers and to lovers, like you say, of the movie, of the book, and of truth, and of, you know, just such a strong female presence. And I loved everything about this book. I am just, I don't know, a little overwhelmed with getting to chat about it, because it was, it was just, like, as a reader and as somebody who's so, you know, we get sent so many books, and I was reading somewhere that you're getting them now to blurb them and to, you know, to know, like, so when they stand out in such a way, it's just like, I want everybody to read this book. And then you want to talk about it, you know, and it's The Secrets We Kept, and visit LaraPrescott.com for information about all of the book tours. Find her on Twitter and on Instagram. And it's really, like you were saying, so cool to see what people are doing, whether they're taking a bite out of the book, or they're cutting it, or they're, you know, putting their...
Having a cat.
Right, animals with it, right? I don't know if I took a picture of Benny with the book.
Oh, do it.
I will. I think... that's right. We are going to do that. I'm going to have my daughter do that. She's a photographer, so it will come out definitely better. But yes, that is in the plan. And I loved reading about the different objects that you collected during the tour that you were collecting while writing the book.
Yeah, there's two prize objects. One is an actual copy of the CIA's Dr. Zhivago. It's actually the miniature edition that was printed on this really thin Bible stock paper. So it was small enough to fit in a pocket.
I love that.
Easy smuggling.
Yes.
Wow. So I have one of those, and that was actually printed in Washington, D.C. under a fake publishing company.
Of course.
I got my husband tracked one down on a Russian auction site and got it for me for my birthday / Christmas. And then another, probably my other prize possession, is a first edition Dr. Zhivago printed in Italy, which is where it was printed for the first time by Feltrinelli.
That is so cool.
So I have, you know, that first run of Dr. Zhivago, and that's so special to me too. Even though I don't read Italian, I don't speak Italian.
But you have it. Yeah. Not yet. In your next iteration.
Maybe my next one.
Yes. And I was remembering too, because I think I read somewhere that you had a jewelry box that played the love theme. I had that.
My mom had it, and I had one all the time.
Yes, I forgot that I had one. That reminded me, and I was thinking, like, the CIA should definitely be involved in distributing books. Like, that's a great way to have, like, a book press party and just, like, go into just, like, smuggle copies
in different ways.
They're like the original bookstagrammers, the CIA.
Yeah.
There you go. Well, I just could not love this book anymore. I really could go on, and I know that our time is limited, so I will not. But people should go to Laura Prescott, LauraPrescott.com, Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, and don't bombard her. Let her write. Go see her at her events that are coming up. Well, I also loved reading that you took the Knopf deal as opposed to a two-book deal where you would just be under that. Like, where's the book? Where's the next book? So, but that you are working on another one. And so I was very excited to read that and hope to run into you maybe at, I see you'll be at Tucson Book Festival, and I will be there.
Yeah, great.
So, yes, and enjoy it all. It just is so much fun to follow you and to see all of the amazing places The Secrets We Kept is going. Do you have time to read right now, or is there anything that you have packed on your tour that you'd like to share?
Let's see. I mean, I just read Ta-Nehisi Coates' book that was just selected for Oprah's book club, The Water Dancer, which is just amazing. And I'm so happy that that's the new Oprah book because so many people will read it.
I loved it. I also picked that up at Book Expo, so I got that.
Oh, great.
I read that around the same time as I originally read The Secrets We Kept. So, yeah.
And I have, I just bought Patti Smith's new book, too, because I'm such a fan of her writing. And
Memoir? Is it her memoir?
Yeah.
Wow, that's awesome. Well, enjoy that. And I was looking at this. This cover, did they get you a green dress like this? Do you have one?
No, I don't have one.
You need a dress like this. Oh,
I know. I mean, it's so gorgeous. I love it so much.
I know. I love what you were wearing. I saw from, I think it was last night. It was really cool.
Looking,
yeah, I thought that was really neat. Go to Instagram and you can check out what Lara's reading and what she's wearing and what she's reading. But yeah, that's the other thing about book tours. So you're in all these bookstores and then there are all these books and everybody's talking books. So I guess you have to save some space or
I know I
shift
can only
home.
Have one at, yeah, I have like a limited amount of space, so I'm like, okay, what is this a thinner book I can take along
I
with
know,
me
right well those so little ones that you it. Smuggled those little CIA copies
I know for real
smuggled in books. Well, thank you so much. It is just such a treat, like I said, to talk to you. And it's The Secrets We Kept, LaraPrescott.com for more information. And we do have copies, actually, that we are giving away, thanks to
Knopf.
And yes, and people can go to Reading with Robin on Facebook for more about that. And maybe you'll have to tell me a secret and see if you'll win one. I don't know. I could have some fun with that. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much for having me.
Oh, pleasure. Looking forward to meeting you in person.
Yeah.
And enjoy the tour.
Thank you so much. Yeah, this has been great.